I'm here with Professor Eudine Barito, Deputy Principal of the Cave-Fill Campus and Professor of Gender and Public Policy in the Institute for Gender and Development Studies, Nita Barrow Unit. And Professor Barito, welcome.
Thank you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. You know, the IGDS is celebrating 20 years as a regional institution. And before I get into some of the questions about your vision for the IGDS, I just wanted to ask you if you had any advice for your 20-year-old self.
My 20-year-old self?
Yes.
Well, this is a hard one because it's going to sound arrogant.
Okay.
But when I look back, there is nothing I would have done differently.
Okay.
I had some fun along the way. I worked very hard. And for me, the Institute was a passion and a mission. It was the center then, of course. And I wouldn't have changed anything. Because I made some mistakes along the way. But I think that I learned from them. And I learned how to network. I learned how to strategize. But I stayed true to wanting to make the center, the Cave-Fill unit that I had responsibility for, a landmark on the campus. And when I demitted the office 5 years ago, after 15 years in the head, I think I did that. And so I can't say to that Eudine 20 years ago, you should have. So I'm pleased with what I did and humbled by it because I could see the successes of it.
Okay. My question now is going to take me back to being a student, and I think one thing that a lot of the graduate students in the program often say about you, and now I'm kind of telling a bit of tales out of school, is that you seem to be personally invested in students moving through the program and doing well, and that what you're able to do is find the richness and the contribution in work that students are unable to even see themselves as they're trying to conceptualize it. And I was wondering, where does that come from?
I'm not even sure. I really don't even know for sure. I remember thinking it came from I had an excellent supervisor, and Jane Flapp, and she was very supportive. And I thought that my strategy to preparing for courses and so on came from her. And I remember when I was writing the course Advanced Feminist Theory, I felt the need to go back and find one of her courses that I thoroughly enjoyed. And I had almost finished the syllabus on Advanced Feminist Theory, and I'm sure you have seen it by well, you were the student and one of the students, and it was fat and thick, and for every concept I had endless reading. And I remember having this shock of my life when I went and pulled out a syllabus from Jane Flax that I had kept. And it was for a course, that a graduate course, and it was 2 pages long. And I figured, like, no, this is not it. This is not it. I mean, like, a couple books and a couple. And I was stunned, but I realized the classes were very rich. But I think I had this passion. And I think I'm also able to see things in people. And I also think people were able to see things in me that I couldn't see in myself at the time. And I remember having this feeling, why are they bothering me? I wish they would leave me alone. But still, because they kept at me, I realized there was stuff in me that they pulled out. And I see it in other students. And yes, I do feel very personally invested in students. And I remember when I was offered the post of deputy principal, the hardest part was leaving the graduate program, because I felt, when I started the program, I didn't know this was coming. And I said to the principal, you have to let me still be involved with the students, otherwise I won't do it. And in fact, one of the threats that I used a lot was like, if there was something I was doing as deputy principal and I thought that if I wasn't getting traction, if I don't get traction on this, I'm going back to the Institute. And so that used to work. I would get something going. But I do feel that people have potential and they often cannot see it within themselves. So that if you, the professor, the supervisor, can hold that person to a higher standard and say, come over here. There's an A over here. There's a great thesis over here. You're not there yet, but I can see it and you can get there. And so rather than hold out all the negatives, to hold out the possibilities. But I think it's perhaps a reflection on my life, because I think that I have been brought from all kinds of places. You know, an immigrant girl in Barbados growing up, teachers, Barbadian teachers insisting that this little girl, boy, do this, do that, and I just moving as a maze. And finally, as a young adult coming to town, maybe I'm intelligent after all, because part of what happened, especially to girls, I think it happens to boys too, but there's an encouragement to doubt yourself. and doubt your potential and not embrace your intelligence and not embrace you have a contribution to make. And I had that to some extent much younger and made peace with that and said, well, you know, this is it. And so whenever I see women and men with opportunity, I do in fact do that. But I think it comes from the unique combination of all my experiences and forever wanting to bring out the best in people.
And final question, mm-hmm. Even from your early work, you are always insisting that you are thinking through, you are theorizing, and you were very explicit about the theoretical offerings of your work, mm-hmm. even at a time when you can read some Caribbean feminists saying mm-hmm. that, you know, why are they doing too much theory, they should right. kind of shy away from theory. And I wanted you to maybe tell us a bit about what do you think has been the key for your understanding of yourself as a thinker so early on in your life?
I have always, from a child, I've been always fascinated by why. I don't like just description. I thought it came as an adult, but I've been talking to my older sisters and they say, you always wanted to know what was going on beneath. And I remember I was in the Institute for Social and Economic Research then when they were doing the Women in the Caribbean Project. I was not on the Women in the Caribbean Project. I was working with a research fellow called Patty Manuel. I was drafted in, but Margaret Gill was my friend. Diane Cummins was my friend. Roberta Clark was my friend. And I would say to them, what are y'all doing? And they say, we're working on this project about women in the Caribbean. And I say, but why are you doing it? And why? What are you hoping to find? And they couldn't give me satisfactory answers. And I even remember I have a very good colleague who was doing, they came to, I could see myself now, it was 1987, I was pregnant. There was a project, some follow-up on the Women in the Caribbean Project. And I said, but y'all just describing things, what is happening behind here? And she said, oh, you must be a reluctant feminist. You got to go read. I wasn't a reluctant feminist. I wouldn't have called myself a feminist, although I have friends then who said that you were always a feminist. But it was like trying the I like deeper explanations. I don't like just descriptive things. And this is why when I went to Howard University and ran in this first course with Jane Flax called Philosophy of the Social Sciences, which was supposed to be a foundation course, but which really started getting into whys and deeper understandings. And people also, I had this beef that theory was taught as if it is something hanging up there, and that ordinary people theorize. People who don't have university degrees theorize. It's a framework for explaining things around you. And that if you could put people in touch with that, theory is both simple and complex. And that having a theoretical understanding actually makes you understand and explain even better. And I think one of the things I've always done, though, is hold the realities of Caribbean societies has been far more important than any theoretical framework. So if there's something happening in the society, is whether or not you like it or don't like it, that is something different. But could the theories that we are learning help us to understand it? So let us say that Trinidadians like mass. Everybody say Trinidadians like the mass, right? Why do Trinidadians like mass? Is there a theoretical explanation, creolization, the admixture of cultures? And if the theories that come to explain that can't explain it, then I think the theories are not adequate. Because for me, what matters is something that you have picked out as being significant in that society, and which is independent of whether or not you like that symptom in the society. But whatever theoretical explanation, and of course you know that I also reject the notion that theory is sometimes used and sometimes not used. Right. There's theory embedded everywhere. So it was the whole idea of pulling that out and searching for deeper explanations, and also having great respect for the intellectual tradition in the Caribbean and respect for Caribbean society. So that it, in a sense, is I wanted both to prioritize our realities, our societies, and create explanatory models that would even help us further.
And to close, where are you hoping to go with your research on love, power, and political sexuality?
Right. I think I really now decide I have another book.
Okay.
And so in the beginning, I was combing the work of Audre Lorde and Anna Yurastore. And so coming out of I would look at other theoretical work around that, but I'm really interested in both of them and seeking a happy combination of their ideas. And then I want to extract from their work and create a set of questions to use with a small focus group of so-called professional women, the kind that look like they have it together, and then find out if the theoretical explanations created by Audre Lorde and Anna Urasure could explain what is happening in these women's lives, and come back from them to make some broader assumptions about those kind of things. But I see a book project hanging around there where I have done a third of it, and the other piece is to go into the field and come back.
Thank you very much, Professor Barito. That's the exclusive interview on the Love, Power, Political Sexuality book project that is forthcoming. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tonya. And it's lovely to have you interview me. Thank you.